We've just released a video over on GCN where Dan and I finally get to check out this new trend of using smaller 650B wheels but fitted with bigger, fatter tyres. Now, there is a lot in that video, but then we also had to leave quite a lot out as well, not least the fact that we both really nearly stacked it on the very first corner of the day, something you've probably already seen. But if you haven't, you've just been able to see it again. Clearly, too good to leave out. Anyway, we thought that we would take the opportunity over here on the tech channel to just delve into the subject a little bit more, to basically really geek out. All right, first things first, the top line. A 650B wheel has a smaller diameter than a traditional 700C road wheel. It measures 584 millimeters across, whereas that 700C wheel measures 622 millimeters across. However, if you actually do put a tape measure across your wheel, you will see that it doesn't measure 622 millimeters at all. And that's because 622 refers to what's called the bead seat diameter. So that's like the innermost bit of the rim where your tire sits. Now, you could be forgiven for asking why on earth they are called this. And it is a very good question. And it basically stems from an old French system of measuring wheels, where 650 and 700 referred to the overall diameter, not just of the wheel, but of the tire as well. And then the letter refers to the width of the tire, so A, B, and C. Now, with the fattest tires, C, you therefore needed a rim that was smaller in order to keep that overall diameter exactly the same. Now, as you can see, that is a pretty crappy system, or at least I think so, and that's probably why we are now down to just two main choices. Or are there? Because there is also 650C, which measures 571 millimeters across. And remember, back in the day, that will have had a fatter tire on it to help it measure up to 650 millimeters total diameter. Now, it is a little used size of wheel, normally on smaller road bikes, but it can't be that little used, to be fair, because Continental still makes 650C road tyres, and there are other options out there as well if you start to look. And Emma Pooley, in fact, won her World Time Trial Championship aboard a Cervelo P3 designed around 650C wheels. Unfortunately, though, Cervelo don't make that bike anymore, and they are starting to fall out of use, but they are now being replaced by 650B. Oh yeah, probably because they have been made popular in recent times by mountain bikers. More on that in a second. Now, while Emma Pooley's World Time Trial Championship victory is still fresh in our minds, let's have a think about performance, shall we? Because there's a commonly held belief that bigger wheels roll better, more efficiently than smaller wheels. And it's something that mountain bikers are all too familiar with. They've been sold the concept for like 10 years now. A 29er, which incidentally uses the same diameter rim as our 700C road ones, so 622 millimeters across, will roll better across bumpy terrain, so faster, more efficiently, than the original mountain bike size wheel, which was 26 inches. Apologies for mixing my Imperial with my metric there. But let's have a quick look at why, shall we? A hypothetical obstacle on a trail, let's call it a rock, measures 5 centimeters high. Now, when that smaller diameter 26-inch wheel hits it, the angle created between the contact patch of the tire on the trail and the obstacle is 128.7 degrees. When the larger 29er wheel hits said obstacle, the angle of attack is also larger, up to 131.1 degrees. And it's that larger angle that means that the larger wheel is able to roll over the obstacle more easily. Now, you might not think that that difference adds up to very much. It is just 2% after all. But as anyone who's ever ridden a 29er can attest to the fact that they do roll over almost anything and significantly better than 26ers. And there's actually a stack of empirical evidence as well to say that 29ers really are faster. However, that sense that bigger wheels are more efficient also exists in our skinny tired world as well. But when you think about it, we don't encounter 5 centimeter high obstacles that much, thankfully. When we do, they tend to be quite catastrophic. What we do encounter all the time are those much, much smaller micro bumps, a few millimeters high, that contributes to that high frequency road buzz that we feel on the bike. And when you think about angles of attack there, the difference between a 700 C wheel and a 650 B wheel are almost nothing, microscopic in fact. And actually you could probably get away from them simply by letting 10 PSI out of your tires. And then when you add into the mix the fact that a 650 B wheel is 7% more aerodynamic than a 700 C, according to Zip, and it's also 12% lighter, there's actually a case to say that smaller wheels could well roll faster than 700C wheels on smooth tarmac anyway. On that GCN video though, only some of it was on tarmac, because as you can see, our 650B wheels have these rather fat, very trendy 47mm wide tyres on them, meaning that we can go off-road, like proper off-road. And with these tyres, the angle of attack question is largely academic too, because the diameter of these tyres is almost identical as the diameter of our cyclocross tyres on our standard 700C wheels as well. Although, given what we've just been talking about, you could quite rightly ask the question, why would you not just put a mountain bike tyre on your road wheel to make it into a 29er, and then you'd be faster? Valid question. For me, the answer lies in geometry, because wheel diameters have a hugely significant effect on the way a bike feels to ride. But it's also the way the bike has to be designed around them. To ride 29er wheels, the bike's gonna have to be longer and bigger in order to fit them in. And that is gonna seriously affect the handling characteristics. For a start, it's likely to feel more stable, / ride like a barge. Then it's also gonna raise you up more, raising your position. But then so that you don't feel like you're 12 feet off the ground, you'll probably find that the bottom bracket will be lower. Now on a mountain bike, this is a really good thing. It makes you feel like you're in the bike, not on the bike. But it's gonna exacerbate that position problem, because while you may not feel like you're 12 feet off the ground anymore, your handlebars probably are 12 feet off the ground. So the theory then is that you use 650B wheels, but with larger tyres, and you can keep the geometry and your position exactly the same as on your road bike. So you get the same handling, same position, you have the same chainstay length, the same fork length, you have the same angles, you've got the same trail, you've got the same wheelbase, you've got the same... So, does it feel identical then? No, it doesn't actually. I mean, it feels really similar when you first get on the bike and you accelerate out the saddle on the road, and then it feels similar when you're riding at slow speeds, like around the car park at the bike shop. But when you go faster and you start cornering at faster speeds, it feels very, very different indeed. And that is because of the width of the tires and something called pneumatic trail. You see, larger tires have larger contact patches with the road. So literally more rubber is in contact with the tarmac at any one time. And that's particularly true if you also make the most of the fact that you can run lower pressures because they are wider tires. Now this gives you more grip, yay! But it can also make the bike feel more sluggish because of that aforementioned pneumatic trail. Now you can literally feel this at the handlebars, because as you turn, the front tire naturally wants to straighten up away from the direction of the turn, meaning that you therefore have to put more force into the handlebars in order to keep going in the direction that you want to. And that is because of force that builds up at the rear of the contact patch, and it generates what's called a self-aligning torque, literally trying to straighten up your front wheel. And it is genuinely really noticeable, even on 30mm wide tires as well. You can combat it by increasing the mechanical trail of the bike, so tweaking the geometry. But then on a bike where you regularly swap between thin tires and fat tires, you have to strike some kind of a balance. And there is also actually a short-term fix as well. By inflating your tires really hard, you will therefore decrease the size of that contact patch. If, having watched the GCN video and also got a bit more info on the tech side, you are keen to give 650B wheels a go, you're probably gonna be wondering, how are you gonna be able to do that? What's compatibility like? What bikes can they fit on? So, the bikes that we rode in the video were kindly lent to us, and they're made by Rondo. They've been designed specifically to fit wider tires on 650B wheels, and also to be swapped, as you saw, with 700C wheels as well. However, you don't necessarily need bikes specifically designed for the purpose. I have been told that quite a few cyclocross bikes will also be able to fit them in, or at least the more modestly sized 47mm wide WTB ones that we've got here, including apparently my own Trek Crockett cyclocross bike. Now, I haven't tried it, and Trek don't say explicitly that you can, although I'm not sure they say explicitly that you can't, but GCN viewer Adam Walton was kind enough to let me know on Instagram that he has been doing exactly that to great effect as well. So you will need tyre clearance, and then you will also, unfortunately, need disc brakes as well, because, of course, rim brakes will not be able to cope with the difference in rim diameters between 650B and 700C. Oh, and then, of course, you'll also need to borrow some 650B wheels. But at this point, if you've got through axles, you could just nick a pair from your mountain bike friends. That's right, watch their face when they see you riding around on a fully rigid drop handlebar bike. Priceless. Anyway, do make sure you give this video a big thumbs up if you like geeking out, and as well as letting us know your thoughts on the subject in the comments section, also let us know if there are other subjects that you want to nerd out on, get involved in a little bit more science, and we will try and do our best. We'll also rope in the services of Mr. John Cannings as well. And then, of course, if you haven't already seen that GCN video, I suggest that you head over there now.